the Yuba City City Council had to wait a minute for the Kirstings to get in here. They were a little bit late. That was payback, Chris. Chris was my pastor, and I would show up at the middle service at St. Andrew Presbyterian Church, and he occasionally would recognize me for my tardiness.
You have to be early to get a good seat in the back row.
All right.
You should make him do the invocation tonight. Just
coming out of closed session. I have a prepared statement. In closed session, the Yuba City Council unanimously agreed to accept the offer of the state that the Judicial Council of California pay Yuba City an additional $169,657 for charges and fees for the Superior Court House project. Moving on, we'll have roll call, please.
Mayor Buckland?
Here.
Vice Mayor Cleveland?
Here.
Councilmember Didball?
Here.
Councilmember Dukes?
Here.
Councilmember Gill?
Aye.
Somewhere.
Somewhere.
Councilmember Dukes will do the invocation, followed by a Pledge of Allegiance, led by Councilmember Preet Didball.
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be your servants here and represent our community. We pray, Lord, that you will give us your wisdom tonight and help us as we make the decisions that affect the citizens of our fine city. We ask this in your most holy name. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We're going to wait on the presentation to the Hmong community as the colonel. We're trying to see if he's anywhere around, but I guess he's going between Marysville and here. All right. Next will be recognition of Yuba City 4th of July Children's Parade and Picnic, all of the community partners. Somewhere I have a whole list of individuals. They give me a cheat sheet, but I always fail to remember where I put it. Corey Kirsting from the Yuba Sutter Symphony, come on up. Pamela Allison, Clean Right Build Right. Is Amos Smith? Oh, there you are. I was looking for you there earlier, Amos, and you were just being hidden behind Mr. Leggins. Leslie Hall from Sam's Club. Stephanie Brown, Sutter Orchard Supply. Mike Leggins from Recology. Michael Worth and Misty Gibson from Lowe's. We will get everybody up here. The 4th of July Children's Parade and Community Picnic is our community's way to commemorate Independence Day for our country. This event has grown over time. The fire chief has been one of those that helped years ago to get this event going. I know that Manny has been involved in it. And it, as it's grown, it has become one of these symbols of our community where the children come out along with their families and we celebrate Independence Day. It's very much, I liken this event very much to what you find back in the colonies. It's something that gives us great pride, gives our community a deeper understanding of what the day really means. It's not a day just to light off illegal fireworks for the 6 days preceding and the 10 after, but it's a day to remember and celebrate with our families just the great country that we have been blessed to live in. These are all the community members and businesses that have partnered to make this an enjoyable event and growing event. There were about 850 hot dogs. This is how we gauge how many people show up. About 850 hot dogs. They were all gone about an hour and a half after the parade ended. So it's great to have all of the coordination and efforts. Pam certainly helped coordinate and get all of the different organizations and businesses together to make sure that we had great representation across the community. And the music, as we come around, we always have to remember to shut off the music on top of the wagon as we come around, but certainly led by Corey. And it's just one of those great patriotic moments that as you pass by and hearing all the music and people standing around just enjoying themselves. Therefore, now it be resolved that I, John Buckland, Mayor of the City of Yuba City, and on behalf of the entire City Council, do hereby commend and thank and compliment Pam Ellison of Clean Right Build Right, The Cookie Tree, Sutter Orchard Supply, Sam's Club, Recology, Lowe's, and their employees, and the Yuba Sutter Symphony for their participation in and commitment to the Yuba City 4th of July Children's Parade and Community Picnic, which results in building a stronger and better Yuba City community. Done on this 16th day of August, 2016, the City of Yuba City, Sutter County. Thank you very much. And I'm going to pass the microphone along because this is a recorded event that the public gets to watch. And you're more than welcome to express anything you would like about it and certainly what you contributed to the event. We'll start with Amos.
I'd just like to thank you for the opportunity to be here for this event and for the acknowledgement of what we've tried to give to the community here. Of course, Mrs. Smith, Sue Smith, would love to be here right now, but can't make it due to complications. But nonetheless, thank you.
Just real briefly, probably about 6 or 7 years ago, my wife and I took our two kids at the time, I think maybe three at the time, to the parade, and there was a little Dixieland band playing, and it was our first time at the parade, and we just thought it was a perfect kind of old town, you know, Americana kind of feel. And the following year, the Dixieland band wasn't there, and we missed it, and I thought, well, I have this symphony that I conduct. I wonder if anybody would want to join us next year. And I talked to the orchestra, and they were all really excited because they love just getting out and being part of our community. And so we've done, I think this was the fourth or fifth year now, and the orchestra loves it, and I have a great time. It's one of my favorite concerts that we do during the year, so it's great to participate in that with the community.
Thank you.
Thank everybody for being here, and thank you for this. And this is just a small reflection of our community.
And on behalf of Sam's Club, we thank you for acknowledging us. We try to do as much as we can for the community. We could always do more, but thank you.
And on behalf of Recology and its employees, I want to thank everybody for this honor. I know Jackie Silman, many of you know her. She couldn't be here because she had to be at the City Council meeting in Marysville, so she misses this. Anyway, we're always happy to help out. Thank you.
On behalf of Lowe's, we always like to be a part of the community, do everything we can, so it was a pleasure doing what we did. Thank you very much.
Stephanie from Sutter Orchard Supply, and I appreciate the recognition, and we always enjoy contributing to our community and those that are younger and show a positive event for them and a reflection of the community as a whole. Thank you.
was going to be an official photographer, so y'all can move in fairly tight.
Slightly.
Oh,
I think he's more like a politician. Oh, no, wait, he's a minister.
That is politics.
Anytime you see representatives from the elected offices coming down, we know that there's something that has happened in our city, and that is the retirement of Gary Marler. So, Gary, come on down. You didn't know that we're going to turn this into a whole hoopla. Gary, I'm going to go first with a proclamation from the city, but this is a very, very long version that you get to hang on your wall and read over and over again just to remember where the gray hair came from.
Gary, how about no hair?
I wasn't going to go there. All right, Gary Marler was our deputy Public Works Director in Maintenance, July 4th, 1987 through July 29th, 2016. Gary Marler retired from the City of Yuba City with 29 years of dedicated service on July the 29th, 2016. Gary began his career at Yuba City as a maintenance worker, one with the Parks Department, and promoted through the ranks to his current position of Deputy Public Works Director of Maintenance in June of 2013. Gary Marler is recognized within the city for his leadership, mentorship, positive attitude, dependability, efficiency, unparalleled work ethic, knowledge, and sincerity. Gary Marler received the award for Employee of the Year in 1992 and was selected to participate in the 2002 Leadership Academy and was recognized by the City Council for his participation in River Watch 1997. Gary Marler was instrumental in promoting leadership within the city through the development of the 2015 and 16 Leadership Academy, the 2016 Fire Department Academy, and the UC Davis Cultivating the Leader Within program to develop supervisory skills in staff. In addition to his work at the city, Gary Marler has served his community by being a reserve deputy sheriff with Sutter County, a member of the board of directors for the Feather River Water District, and a district member of Sutter Local Agency Formation Commission, and a member of the Sutter County Fish and Game Advisory Commission. Gary has inspired his team and peers with firm compassion and high standards. His contributions to the city are invaluable and his integrity admirable. The one note that I get to add is Gary only called in sick five days in his entire service here with the City of Yuba City. And it was a small number of days. So it came to mind that either you were extremely healthy, or you spread your illness among the troops. Now, therefore, it be resolved that I, John Buckland, Mayor of the City of Yuba City, on behalf of the entire City Council, hereby commend Gary's outstanding loyal service and sincerely urge all residents of the City of Yuba City to join me in recognizing Mr. Gary Marler for all of his contributions to the city and the community for the last 29 years. Done on the 16th day of August. Thank you. And I'm going to turn this over to the next presentation.
Thank you very much. On behalf of Senator Nielsen and Assemblyman Gallagher, it is our pleasure, our honor, our privilege to be with you tonight to present this joint resolution from the California State Legislature. As you have heard of the many things that are included, it summarizes your career. It thanks you for your leadership, your strength in the community, for all that you've done, and it concludes wishing you all of the best in your retirement, and thank you so much.
And I think we're done. I also have from Congressman Garamendi's office a congressional commendation presented to Gary W. Marler, dedicated public servant, this 16th day of August, 2016. It is a great pleasure to join with the Yuba City Council and recognize Gary Marler for 29 years of service to the City of Yuba City Public Works Department. Gary's leadership, positive role, modeling, and commitment to the community boards and commissions are commendable. On behalf of California's 3rd Congressional District, please accept his sincerest gratitude to Gary and best wishes in the years ahead. Signed by Congressman John Garamendi. Now I'm going to take all these things from you because I'm going to hand you what I have in my hand and give you the opportunity for a few words.
Okay, so first of all, I want to thank my family for all their support over the years, especially my wife. I can't think of one instance where she ever complained about one of the calls I got in the middle of the night or having to work on weekends, Sundays, calls during vacations. She never complained one time. Second, I'd like to thank the city for all the opportunities they presented me over the years. I think that spending half my life here, basically at the city so far, kind of shows that, you know, I really want to be a part of this group. It's like family. And now that I'm gone, it's like I've moved out of state away from my actual family. And I think about you guys every day, and I hope to get back and do some volunteering soon. Thank you.
Gary. And Colonel, if I could get you to come down. Do you want to bring everyone down?
Oh, yeah.
Anybody that came with the Colonel? Oh, that's fine. We explained that you're running between different locations, so. All right, this is Hmong History Month, coming up September of 2016. The history of the Hmong people here in the United States is indeed unique and vibrant, and it's appropriate to celebrate this history during the upcoming month. The Hmong, or free people, are greatly respected and admired for their dedicated service and valiant support of the United States Armed Forces and its allies during the Vietnam War. The members of the Laotian Hill Tribe are known for their warrior traditions, loyalty, and bravery, as evidenced by their contributions to gathering critical intelligence on enemy movement and operations, performing rescue missions to save downed United States pilots, and fighting in conventional and guerrilla combat against overwhelming forces. A conservative estimate of over 35,000 brave Hmong men, women, and children lost their lives. More than 50,000 were wounded, and more than 2,500 are missing in action. The Hmong's heroic and significant contributions to the United States during their fighting efforts in Laos, and the positive influence that they have had upon the American way of life will not be forgotten. Now, therefore, it be resolved that I, John Buckland, Mayor of the City of Yuba City, and on behalf of the entire City Council, ask all residents of this city to join me in honoring the Hmong men and women who served the United States with loyalty, bravery, and celebrate the contributions the Hmong people make to our communities. Done this 16th day of August, 2016, here in Sutter County.
First of all, I want to thank the City Mayor Buckland, and along with City Council, all yes, especially Mary or Terry. I've been working back and forth. thank you guys for the City of Yuba City for you guys the past few years. You've been supporting the Hmong History Month, and I look forward for working with you guys. And as the younger generation, which our kids are future leaders, that's what I put them as. For example, like these Germans standing here, they just can't speak English, but they know every single word we're just going to talk about. So, not only that, I just want to thank all of you guys tonight for being here. And especially the official from the City of Marysville for still keeping the support of the Hmong History Month. And we're looking forward to working with other county or state officials as well. And I could see both State Senator Nelson and James Gallagher's staff right there. Been working real close with them. They've been real supportive, so I want to thank you guys both. And not only that, most of all, during the stand down, hopefully, we get the stuff from the Department of Defense. We're going to be, just got announced, be part of the partners. So, we're going to, hopefully, we'll be honoring some veterans as well, especially those who deserve it all. Who gave all their life. Now that's why we're standing here in front of you guys. Yeah. Set an example for our kids, for the community, for the nation. So, remember much. They're still feeling ashamed, but they're not, but they just act like that. One of the, I didn't want to say shy, but that's embarrassing. but one of the main mission that we want, hopefully, that you guys, as representative and official, will keep on pushing us and support us in the future. That will push this Hmong History Month to go nationwide. And once they go nationwide, it doesn't come where any other county, but it starts from Yuba City County area. So that would be one of the most, I think it would be most incredible things that happen in our area. So I want to look forward for all your support, and thank you all the officials for the past few years. It's Steph, especially this gentleman behind me. And Mayor Buckland just served as sheriff deputy. I'm a former deputy sheriff, so that's right. My last comment, I just got to mention about that one.
I was a police officer, but everybody to you is a deputy sheriff, so. Thank you very much. And we've... And the effort, as we begin this effort here, we hope to carry it nationwide and help promote this and certainly the cause that's behind all of this. So thank you very, very much. Okay. Thank you. All right, we'll move on in the agenda to the public hearing section. Item number four, Recology Yuba Sutter rate adjustment for rate year 2017 and related amendment to the 2011 collection service agreement presented by our city manager, Mr. Krieger.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, good evening. The item before you concerns the annual adjustment of solid waste rates. For our upcoming rate year 2017, starting in October, would propose that rates be adjusted by 1.18%. This is inclusive of a 1% franchise fee increase that will be dedicated in Yuba City to the repair and maintenance of residential roads. What's the practical effect on most of us who live here? It's about 32 cents a month. So, aside from the rate adjustment, the collection service agreement amendment also issues use of set-aside funds that have been put aside over the years in the rate stabilization and capitalization fund for certain project costs that are outlined in the staff report. I'd like to point out one specific item in the staff report that concerns the post-closure maintenance account. What is that? That's required money that the state requires to be set aside to provide assurance that closed landfills are not abandoned, meaning that there's an ongoing responsibility for maintenance of closed landfills. As you know, in Marysville, our transfer station, ours, meaning our regional one, operated known by Recology. By the way, I was remiss a bit. I did not mention we do have Mike Leggins. We have Tom Norris and Phil Graham, all representatives of Recology who have assisted in all of this process. So specifically with that post-closure maintenance account, the staff report identified an amount of $167,839. The adjusted amount is $182,038. That amount has been updated in both the resolution and the updated collection service agreement amendment that was placed on your dais this evening. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have. And this is an opportunity for the public to provide input as well.
Any questions before we open this to the public for comment? None? We'll open a public hearing. Any member of the public that wishes to speak to this matter may do so by going up to the podium, state your name. You have 3 minutes to speak. I see no mad rush. We'll close the public hearing. We'll bring it back to council for action.
Move to approve the item.
Second that.
I did have a question before we move on. It's okay. And I was just wondering, I know how closely Recology follows some of the bills that, or any of the solid waste people do. And on the bill, Assembly Bill 1063, it is on our agenda item here. What is the probability that that will pass? Because I know you're following it close. Just curious if you have any idea. That's where it's going to go from 140 to 400.
Well, maybe Mike Leggins, the general manager of Recology, would like to approach the podium to address your council.
What's the feeling is what I'm trying to find out.
Good
Council Member Buck, through the mayor, and Stan Cleveland. My name is Mike Leggins with the Recology Yuba Center. The feeling is the legislature right now, there is the bill that that would drive the landfill tipping fee increase, and basically that's kind of a fund that the state will just use for they're planning on recycling things, but it has no support at least over the next couple years. It has been brought up, I think, in the past 4 years. It's been brought up, periodically. But the next legislative sessions, they don't expect it to go up over the next couple of years. Again, I think the state's always looking for additional funds, and this is one way that they're able to gain some access to some of those funds.
We know the state's always looking to take more away from us, so I'm just curious as to that, where that was at right now. Thank you. Appreciate
it. You're welcome.
Any other discussion?
Call for the question.
Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Moving on to item number 5. Fifth Street Bridge Replacement Project, report on feasibility of providing public access to the Feather River for recreational purposes, compliance with Section 1809 of the California Streets and Highways Code, presented by Diana Langley, our Public Works Director. Diana.
Good evening, Mayor, Council. So as noted, Section 1809 of the California Streets and Highways Code requires the city to consider feasibility of providing public access to the river as part of the Fifth Street Bridge Replacement Project. As part of that, the city was required to prepare a report and then hold the public hearing tonight. The report has been prepared, and the findings are as follows. Multiple points of access to the river exist on both sides of the river in the project area. Providing additional access on the Yuba City side is restricted by steep levee slopes and existing development. Providing additional access on the Marysville side would be unsafe for traffic on Fifth Street and difficult to secure during closed hours. The project will improve ped and bike connections from the bridge on both sides, and Yuba City and Marysville will install additional signage to direct users to existing public access points. So based upon that, it is not feasible to provide additional access to the Feather River as part of this project.
Thank you very much. Any questions of Diana before we open this to the public?
Nope.
Seeing none, open this to public hearing. Any member of the public that wishes to speak to this matter may do so. You have individually 3 minutes each to speak to this. Once again, nobody even wants to talk about this, huh? All right. We'll close the public hearing, bring it back to council for action.
To the mayor. I'll make a motion for staff's recommendation.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Thank you very much. Another stellar job there, Diana. Public communication, you're welcome and encouraged to participate in this meeting. Public comment is taken on items listed on the agenda when they are called. Where's everybody going? Public comment on items not listed on the agenda will be heard under item 7, which is appearance of interested citizens. Comments on controversial items may be limited, and large groups are encouraged to select representatives to express the opinions of the group. Written requests. Do we have any written requests?
No requests were received.
Thank you very much. And moving on to item 7, appearance of interested citizens. Members of the public may address the City Council on items of interest that are within the city's jurisdiction. Individuals addressing general comments are encouraged to limit their statements to 3 minutes. Any member of the public wish to speak? Once again, we'll be moving on. Moving on to bid openings. Item number 8, Yuba City Demolition Award, and this will be presented by Mr. Ben Moody, our Deputy Public Works Director, Engineering. Ben.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the Council. The item before you is in regards to the Yuba City Demolition Project. It is basically regarding the demolition of 3 residential properties, 2 on Long Bridge Street for the future Bridge Street widening, and 1 along Walton, just south of the Fire Station 4. It's in a dilapidated state. The two The two projects on Bridge Street are basically two more in the process to start the planning for the future of the widening project between Gray Avenue and Cooper. And as you can see from the map, the city owns, or publicly owned through the RDA or through the city, the parcels in yellow. And we're starting to focus on, as we acquire these properties, to start moving forward with the demolition. Go right to the next. And then on Walton, so here's two pictures of the Bridge Street residences. We can flip through those. And then one more, and then on Walton. This building's been here for a while. It looks really bad. This is probably a nice picture of it. And so we're going to get rid of it. And so we grouped the projects together to get a better bid. The original engineer's estimate was about $103,000. We received 8 bids, ranging from $62,000 to $140,000 and change. And so we got a really good bid, we feel like. We contacted the contractor. He felt comfortable with his bid, and so he's ready to go once we get authorization to do it. To help fund the project, we're requesting a supplemental appropriation to bring money from the general fund to pay for demolition work along Walton, and then also funds for the Bridge Street widening. DIF funds will be utilized for the projects along Bridge Street. So if you have any questions, staff recommends A through C.
Any questions have been from?
To the mayor, just a quick question. We're demolishing two of the houses there on Bridge Street. What is the plans to start demolishing the rest of them that are city owned?
The word for me is I'm going to demolish them as soon as I can to move forward and prepare for the project.
Thank you.
Any other questions have been? Action from the council?
To the mayor, I'll go ahead and make a motion for staff's recommendation.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
Get to work. Yeah, we want to get this going. Moving on to number 9, award of contract for the disking and slip plying of the wastewater treatment facility effluent discharge ponds. I don't know who wants this job, but Diana, our public works director, is gonna
I love this job.
Fill us in.
I love this job. I love talking about our wastewater ponds. So the city has two options for discharge of our treated effluent. One is through our diffuser that's located in the river bottoms in the Shanghai Bend area. As you recall, with the change in the riverbed, that diffuser is out of the water most of the time now. And so the option that we've been using for the last few years is to discharge to our evaporation percolation ponds located on the east side of the Feather River. Over time, those ponds lose efficiency just because of, you know, sedimentation. The soil gets compacted. And so we go in and we disc to remove weeds, and then we rip to fracture the underlying soil to improve the percolation. We went out and received 3 proposals for the slip plowing. When we did that, we were ready to award a contract to Mechanical and Irrigation Solutions. And then we were contacted by the Mosquito Control District about the need to disc after we slip plow because the furrows are too deep for the mosquito fish. And so then we added in the disking of the ponds as well. So the award tonight is for the ability to disc and slip plow all 6 ponds. We don't think we're going to be able to get to that this year because you have to take a pond out of service to allow it to dry enough to be able to rip and then put it back in service. For the last about month and a half, we've been able to discharge to the river based upon the increased flows from the Feather River. And so we've been able to dry more ponds than what we thought we were going to be able to. So we're going to be able to go in and disc and rip about 3 ponds this summer. Doubtful that we'll get to the total of 6, but we wanted to get authorization just in case we're able to get it worked out. So the item before you tonight is to award the slip plowing and the disking to Mechanical and Irrigation Solutions.
Okay. Any questions of Diana?
To the mayor.
Just a point of clarification. In the report, it says that disking helps minimize the large berms and deep crevices and valleys that can harbor mosquitoes. I want to clarify that it's actually the mosquito fish that get down in those just for a point of education, the mosquito vector district breeds mosquito fish in those ponds, and then they harvest those fish out of the ponds when the numbers increase. And so with those deep furrows, they can't run the seine nets because the mosquito fish actually get down in the grooves and they can't get the fish out. So this is to help so that we can actually pull more of the fish out, because those fish are then in turn used in the rice fields and other areas to help to eradicate the mosquito larvae. So just wanted to clarify that a little bit. There's no mosquitoes in the pond because mm-hmm. the fish are there, but that's to make it more efficient for the breeding of the fish and harvesting of the fish.
Through Mayor, just a quick question. When we're ripping this ground 6 feet deep and they're still going to disc it, we do know that the ground's not going to be leveled because you're bringing it up quite a bit. And does it have, even if they disc it, you're still going to have some peaks and valleys where it's going to sit in high and low. Does it matter if it's leveled or not?
Not from our operational standpoint. It's more for the mosquito district.
Okay. I mean, it'll percolate. I mean, it'll open up the ground quite a bit, but your ground's going to have some really high runs and mm-hmm. lows in it. So, and it'll take a while for the rain from following year's rain to start settling that dirt down.
Mm-hmm.
So. Well, the disking is basically to help kind of level out and get rid of some of those deep furrows. Some of them, yes. So that's why it was requested that we do that additional step as we do this to make it more efficient for the harvesting of the fish.
Just out of curiosity, was the mosquito vector paying for that since it asked for it to be dissed?
No, the city actually gets the benefit of having the fish in there to keep the mosquitoes down in those ponds. So it's a mutual beneficial situation.
I'd like to move for approval.
Second that motion.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Sound like that one went through unanimously also. Consent calendar. All matters listed under the consent calendar are considered to be routine, can be enacted in one motion. There'll be no separate discussion on these items prior to the time that the council votes on the motion, unless members of the city council, staff, or public request for specific items to be discussed or removed from the consent calendar for individual action.
Through the mayor.
Go ahead.
I'd like to have item number 17 handled separately.
Okay.
And with that, I'll make a motion to approve the consent calendar, except item number 17.
All right.
Second that motion.
We have a motion and a second for items 10 through 16. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? No. Carries. Thank you.
And with that, I'll take up discussion if there is any on number 17 or action.
I'd like to move for approval of item number 17.
Second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
And I
opposed or abstain?
I'll be abstaining as I have a business and residence nearby both of the or all of the continuous project.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Oh, that's right. I already did that.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's so double aye.
Twice. Yeah, did it twice.
Do I need to abstain twice?
Yeah. Okay, now moving on, general items. Give it back to the mayor.
Item number 18, cooperative agreement with the Sutter County Department of Transportation for preparation of project study report, project development support project initiation document for the State Route 99, State Route 20 urban interchange. Diana Langley.
So as the part of the transportation workshop earlier this year, council directed staff to work with Caltrans in terms of how we could move forward at least the concept of an urban interchange at the SR99-SR20 intersection. We approached Caltrans about the next steps to do that. Their recommendation was the project study report, project initiation document, to evaluate up to four alternatives for an urban interchange at that location. The cost estimate is $292,000. The work would be performed by Caltrans staff. So the cooperative agreement before you tonight lays out the terms of responsibility, scope of work, and then the funding. And the estimated time for completion of the project initiation document is 16 months. So with that, staff is recommending execution of the cooperative agreement.
Any questions of Diana?
No questions. Comment?
Questions, comments?
comment here. Thank you, Diana, for moving forward with this. And this springs up from the fact my time on the Board of Supervisors, I learned that if we are going to get it, you ever have an agency or a county or a city wants something to get done with Caltrans, you have to initiate it, push them into whether they say, yeah, we'll work with you or not. It just, I learned that working on the Highway 99 projects at Riego Road and Highway 20 and 113. So they've kind of put us off for a long time. And the widening, the way it's designed right now, as Mayor Buckland has said in the past, actually is non-compliant, the design with the standards of the state of California and Caltrans already. It's huge so that it can avoid major accidents and people have time to hit the brakes and stop. And so they've oversized it for avoiding having to build an interchange there, overpass. Well, I've also learned that development around that section is stagnant, and it'll remain that way until we have a true interchange overpass system. And that's just one of the things I learned at the when I was at the county. And so we want to move forward with development of a vital area of our city where we can get revenue, business that are focused on and off ramps. And where national investors will actually come in and say, hey, we want to put something there. And so we want to move forward. That's the reason that for this effort is to actually move forward in a way that many other communities already have done. So thank you for taking this step. And instead of 2035, we're getting it started in 2015-16. So yes, 2035 is when their projection was. So thank you.
And it, to kind of carry on with that.
Very instrumental also, by the way, helping Mayor. Thank you.
With the whole interchange itself, the view of that intersection began well back, probably the late 50s, with some of the freeway construction that happened north of Yuba City into the design of that. And then the building of that in the 60s, and there's just constant work. But Caltrans went out and purchased large amounts of land around that location, 99 and 20, with the design of an interchange there. And that's why businesses today that are located there cannot develop or do anything with those properties. And so when you look at a trailer, why is a trailer sales sitting at a prime location for potential commercial viewing? It's because nobody else can really go there. And so that property then abuts all the way to the west near the transmission muffler shop, I think. Mm-hmm. Yes, and there's a little easement piece back in there for the county. But this is a large interchange. The design that was shown to the city of Yuba City that Caltrans was somewhat happy to show us is exactly the same intersection that exists on I-5 currently about 100 miles south of us. It's the exact same design. We don't see that as a fitting design for Yuba City, so we will continue to work over the course of time with Caltrans to develop something that will be aesthetically pleasing, but also not block or create a large high-rise buffer to separate our city. So we're looking for something in a lower profile that can go into that area. So by us initiating this and working with Caltrans and showing that the citizens of Yuba City are willing to advance this project, I think will also give us at least a voice of leverage as design and other attributes of that intersection come into play in the future. Any other comments?
I'd like to move to approve the item.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All right. You're not off the hook yet, Diana. Fifth Street Bridge Replacement Project Construction Management Requests for Proposals Authorization. Diana.
So the Fifth Street Bridge project, we currently have 90% plans, and Yuba City is still on track to start construction of this project of July of 2017. So we're even though there's stories out there about the funding, and yes, the funding in terms of the grant is an issue, but we're still proceeding as though we are starting construction next July. So with that said, the construction portion of the project is estimated at nearly $56 million. A project of this magnitude requires significant oversight from a construction management standpoint, beyond that of the abilities of city staff to take on that workload. And so what we're recommending tonight is that you authorize the Public Works Department to issue requests for proposals for construction management inspection services for the Fifth Street Bridge replacement project. Typically, a construction management contract is approximately 15% of the construction costs. We're estimating somewhere in the range of 11%, so that would total approximately $6 million. This would be reimbursable through the funding programs for the bridge. And, it's important for us to be able to issue the RFP now in August to then be able to have somebody on board to start pre-construction activities next April. And so that's why it seems kind of odd that we're coming so soon in advance, but it's really going to take that amount of time to go through the process and then award a contract to a CM firm. When we get the proposals, we will have a joint review group from Sutter County, Yuba County, Marysville, and Yuba City participating in the review of the proposals, and then have a recommendation for the City Council as the lead agency for award of the contract. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Questions of Diana?
Nope.
Seeing none, action from the council.
To the mayor, I'll make a motion to move staff's recommendation.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Thank you, Diana. Let's get them on board. Moving on to the most stimulating conversation of the evening. Presentation of our investment report, quarter ended June 30th, 2016. Spencer Morrison, our accounting manager and elected city treasurer. Thank you very much for that report, Spencer.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. I guess I'm...
Clicker.
Okay. Ready to go? So this is the fourth quarter portfolio value slide. The market value is $98.2 million. $97.1 million of that is city held, and another million in is trustee held. The this is a $3.5 million net increase from last quarter. It does include some major cash flow items in that it has the installment of the second installment of the property tax from the county at about $7 million. It has payroll about $9.6 million, which is a little bit higher if you're following it, a little bit higher than normal because there were three paydays in the month of June. And the flood control capital fund received about $2.7 million in levies in that tax installment, and it spent about $7.3 million on projects during the quarter. There were 13 investments matured or sold, and 13 purchased. The average yield sold is 1.158%, and the average yield of those purchased was about 1.757. The city-held composition is made up of about 19% agency bonds, 11% U.S. Treasuries, muni and state bonds are about 5%, corporate bonds are about 15%, and CDs make up 6%. So about 56% of the city-held funds are in bonds. And the remainder, 44%, is made up of local agency investment funds, or LAIF, at 33%, and cash, money markets, and cash-like investments at 11%. The city-held investment portfolio maturity distribution is such. We use the laddering strategy, where we do need to keep quite a bit of cash or cash equivalent on hand, very liquid, mostly more than in many years past, just because of the flood control agency treasury and making sure that we have plenty of funds on hand for cash flow for the project. And otherwise, this distribution reflects a conservative portfolio that favors anticipated slight increases in interest rates in the coming quarters, as well as large construction-related cash flows from the flood control project. And with that, I will entertain any questions.
Anybody want him to repeat that again? Any questions of Spencer?
Nope.
Spencer, it looks like you're doing better with the money. That's nice to see.
I had 4 years of practice.
Yeah. Okay. All right. We'll just note and file. Thank you very much. Business from the City Council. These will be reports, starting with Councilmember Titball.
Couple of weeks. We had a couple of workshops while we were out. We had the National Network. We also had the special workshop with the Regional Waste Management last week, and that was open to the public, so it was a good viewing there. We also had the National Night Out, which was a great evening of visiting several neighborhoods. Had a good time, great food, great conversation. Great people out there, so really enjoyed that night. I think LAFCO was canceled, and that was about it. Really, we had a slow month with the summer months, so.
All right. Thank you very much. Moving on to Councilmember Dukes.
Just a couple things to report. Obviously, the National Night Out a couple weeks ago in lieu of our City Council meeting, it's always a pleasure to get out into the committee or the community, and to meet with the citizens and answer their questions, and ride along with the police, and especially in today's atmosphere across the country where police are being targeted on many levels, it's good to be in a community where there still is respect for our police department and the personnel that keep us safe, and so it's good to go out and be a part of that and to answer questions for the community. I had the Sutter Buttes Flood Control Agency meeting last Wednesday. Nothing really to report out of that. Mosquito Vector meeting last Thursday. We do have one human case of West Nile virus in Yuba County to report. There are 10 in the state. There are a few open cases at this point, but nothing has been confirmed yet. And that's all I have to report at this time.
All right. Moving on to Council Member Cashgill.
I do want to also echo that the National Night Out, I thought was great. Walking and visiting with a lot of different neighborhoods. You get to find out what's going on, what neighborhood. We heard stuff anywhere from street racing, and depends on what area you were street racing, to homeless issues, to which I thought was kind of strange, was somebody was telling us that two gentlemen and lady was knocking on their door in the middle of the night and wanted them to open the door because they said that their cell phone was tracked them inside this house. So open the door, we need our cell phone. And they said, no, we're not going to open the door. They said, if you don't open the door, we're going to call the police. And so the person inside is, well, I've got the police on the line. So I mean, it just tells you that, you know, no matter where you are, you may think you're safe, but you never want to open up doors to any strangers that you don't know. But we did get a lot of thank yous to the police officers from a lot of the citizens, thanking the police officers for a wonderful job they do for protecting and serving us. And I thought that was very, very nice to show their support, their appreciation. A lot of great food, a lot of great people. So I thought it was done very, very nice. We did have the Sutter Buttes Flood Control Agency meeting. Fortunately, I was out of town for the whole week, bank meetings in Seattle. So I was unable to make it, but I'm sure, Mr. Mayor, you were able to cover in my absence. So I'll leave that to you. So that's all I have.
All right. Thank you. Moving on to Vice Mayor Cleveland.
Thank you. Had a Gilsizer meeting. It was a bit short. Was unable to hold the closed session because council members had a conflict, so it was going to have to be the three county. I think they had that today at 4 o'clock. Then we had the regional waste management workshop, and one of the things that I gathered is it seems like that our meeting here was the most the best meeting they'd had, because most of the others had been a bit volatile at times. In fact, the one they had that morning, I heard through the grapevine that there was some vitriol and some was pretty tough on the presentation. But we were able to give some strong questions, requests, and direction for them to bring back to us to consider and have good information for the public. We did have August 1st, FRACMID, Feather River Air Quality Management District, had a meeting there. And we did a lot of budget items and discussions. And then, of course, August 2nd, in lieu of our meeting, a national night out, I was able to go into a completely different area of the city, beat one rather than my area, and get a different perspective of the issues that they have compared to where I live. We promoted the YC311 that people can call and, I mean, get on the computer or on their phone and report things to the city. And I have been hearing good things about that app because the results and action has been very quickly done on the requests. Things that used to fall through the cracks because of just getting from department and information is not occurring at this time. So everybody's very happy. And I know that at the fairgrounds we had this last week or week and a half, our own booth there for the Yuba City, and that was one of the talks that they had there, and people were very pleased to know that we've done that change and they will be using it. Other than that, you saw me with a cane. Something broke loose behind my right knee, so neurosurgeon's going to have to get in there and probably repair it, and that's why I have a cane. That's it.
All right. Moving on, I guess, to my report. I'm walking fine.
Not talking so well this earlier, but...
Who knows? It must have been something I ate earlier.
Chinese food.
Maybe. All right. I attended a number of meetings for SACOG down in Sacramento. Specifically, two meetings since we last were together for the government relations and the administrative arm for SACOG, and looking at a number of things moving forward down there. Primarily, we were adjusting some budget numbers for the different expenditure accounts, and then also authorizing a little bit of some policy more directed at the projects that were put behind schedule by the California Transportation Commission with delaying funding. So that policy change now allows for movement of federal money to fill the gap for the state money until the state money can repay the federal money. So that was one large action that came about. Also down at SACOG, these running back and forth down there, we're also interviewing and trying to locate on a national search a new CEO, as Mr. McKeever will be retiring on December 31st, and we hope to have a new CEO down there in place by right around the 1st of November, so we can have some a little bit of cross-pollinization of information between the old and the incoming. But we had an extremely talented group of about 35 people nationally apply for that position. National Night Out was a great time. I got to ride with the canine, Yuba City's only canine officer and dog. And it was, I got to ride in the front seat, which was good because the dog appeared to be kind of hungry. But we went to a number of different locations, and the dog did the handler and dog did some demonstrations at different locations. And the handler thought it would be great to get me into a bite suit and let the dog bite me. But I politely declined that. And so an officer stood in and did that. Once I saw what his arm looked like, appreciative of the fact that I had good common sense to say no. But anyway, that was a great hit out there with everyone. You also notice throughout the city that the 311, there's some informational signs going up on streetlights all over the city. They have a great appearance. There will be also some messaging that will be out with those. Attended the in Cash's stead, I attended the Sutter Buttes Flood Control Agency meeting, and the action taken out of that was fairly minimal, but gained a great deal of information in the 2 weeks preceding your absence, because he knew he was going to be gone, just getting filled in on some of the recent developments that had occurred and some of the settlements being made with the Auburn Indian tribe. Also the Gil Sizer meeting that had very little action. I think we had approved their basic budget changes and things like that. So that was all. And tonight, I'm going to...
Nice. Yep. One item that I forgot to bring.
You had your opportunity.
I'm bringing it back. Really quick, just as a reminder, if you haven't seen this, the next community forum that I'm holding is August 30th at Boyd Hall, and it's on internet safety, cyberbullying, and sexting. So it's a forum that's continued from last time, so we'll have the FBI agent, and he's actually going to be talking a little bit more extensive compared to last time. So it's a great forum. It's being passed around to all the students and parents, and we'll be continuing to notify families. So we're expecting a lot of information this night. It's a two-hour forum, so lots of information. So pass the word and make sure that students and parents are getting out there.
And I'm going to adjourn tonight's meeting in honor of my mother. It's her birthday today. She turned 89.
Yay.
Meeting adjourned.